So what I'm going to do first, I'm going to give you a little bit of a kind of potted race through history of Sicily, because it's quite important to understand all the many different influences that kind of find their expression in the mosaics of Monreale, and also to speak a little bit about the connections, which are many and kind of surprising, between the island off the south of Europe and this island off the kind of north of mainland Europe. There's some particular connections, especially in this cathedral. So let's get on with it. So there's a saying that who controls Sicily controls the Mediterranean. And this is because this map, which essentially shows what we could call the ancient kind of Roman Empire, Sicily is there slap bang in the middle. And if you wanted to travel around the Mediterranean, whether it was from east to west, from kind of Asia Minor here up to Spain and then beyond into the Atlantic and maybe up to Britain to get your tin to make the bronze and various other things. And if you wanted to come from the west to the east, you would always have to make your way past Sicily, whether on the south coast between kind of Tunisia and Sicily, or this tiny little kind of slip of sea between Sicily and the toe of the boot that is Italy, what the Greeks called Scylla and Charybdis. That was a very kind of dangerous area to pass through. And Sicily, in fact, suffered a little bit from its own position in being constantly invaded from more or less from three directions. So it was constantly being kind of fought over by the Greeks coming in from the west, by the Carthaginians and the North Africans, later the Arabs coming in from the south, and from the Romans obviously coming up from the north, and later on, and particularly important in what we're speaking about today, the Normans who came down through here. So I'm going to give you, I mean, Sicily has an incredible kind of history and has the number of different kind of civilizations that have passed through and left their mark on Sicily. We could have, you know, a year or two speaking about those, but I'm going to try and run through it in 5 minutes. So forgive me, it's going to be very, we're just going to touch on the surface. So there is quite a bit of prehistoric activity in Sicily, and there's cave paintings and all sorts, but we're going to leave those at the moment. We're going to start our timeline in 733 BC, when the Corinthians, lots of the Greeks in the kind of 8th, 7th, 6th century were looking for new places to colonize. And the first place that the Greeks went west, they touched down in Sicily, in Syracuse, in the sort of southeast of the island, and founded the Corinthian colony of Syracuse. So the Greeks began to have an effect on Sicily from there. And from then on, Sicily was kind of, it was a bit like the United States for the Greeks. It was a place where people went to get rich quick. Everything was big, brash. You could make a lot of money there. And their temples were bigger. Their horses were faster. You know, it really was considered a bit like the United States is to Europe. They also considered Sicily a little bit kind of, you know, nouveau riche and not very tasteful. But we enjoy the kind of grandiose buildings that were left there in Syracuse and Agrigento and other places in Sicily. The next bunch who came along and left their mark on Sicily are the Carthaginians, who come up from that kind of Tunisia area, which is the closest area in North Africa. And they were particularly influential in the west of Sicily. So in the west of Sicily, it was like a day's sailing from Carthage to the west of Sicily. And the city of Palermo was in fact, first of all, a Carthaginian settlement, Panormus, it was called. The next people who kind of sweep into Sicily and leave their mark are the Romans. So the Romans, in their constant battle with the Carthaginians, it was very important to take control of Sicily to finally put down the Carthaginians, Hannibal, and all the rest of it, the First and the Second Punic Wars. So the Romans come, and in 227 BC, they take over Sicily, and it becomes the first Roman province. So it's the first kind of extraterritorial area that the Romans take over after the peninsula of Italy itself. The Romans kind of treated Sicily quite badly and really essentially kind of plundered it, took away all its art and used it especially for the latifundia, these huge slave staffed farms. And Sicily, with being very fertile area, became one of the main grain producers for Rome. So the Romans didn't put an awful lot into Sicily, but they took an awful lot out of it. What happened next? Well, from our point of view today, one of the important people who visited Sicily passing through was St. Paul on his way up to Rome. He lands in Syracuse and he preaches there in 59 AD. So there's a long period of about 500-600 years of Roman rule. Then in 410 AD, when the Vandals and the Goths sweep down Italy, sack Rome, and they also take over Sicily. And this is quite important because the Vandals were in fact Arians. They believed in a particular kind of heresy, which believed that Christ was not God from the beginning. There was a time when he was not, and that he was later assumed into the Trinity. And it was one of the most important kind of Christological controversies of the first five centuries of the church. And orthodoxy that Christ is God only kind of won through in about the 5th, 6th century. And that's kind of quite important for some of the art that we see in Monreale, which we'll explain a bit later on. After that, the Byzantine Roman Empire slowly begins to kind of come back into the West and reconquer parts of North Africa and Sicily itself. So the Byzantines, who are kind of Orthodox Christians — when I say Orthodox, I mean correctly believing about Christ. The Eastern Orthodox hadn't kind of split off just yet. They take control of Sicily in 535 AD and kick the Vandals out. So Sicily again becomes kind of Greek dominated. Within a couple of hundred years — oh, and at this point something important happens kind of here, which is Christianity comes to Britain again with St. Augustine of Canterbury. And there is some debate about Augustine of Canterbury's origins, but there seems to be some idea that in fact he may have come from Sicily himself. We have a letter from the Archbishop of Messina to Gregory, the Pope Gregory, who sent Augustine to England. And he seemed to know Augustine very well and calls him one of his colleagues. And so we have a feeling that he may have actually come from Sicily. Then in the year 711, the first kind of Arab incursion to Sicily starts. So up through Tunisia into the west of Sicily, and then slowly the Arabs take over the whole of Sicily. And they set up the Emirate of Sicily. And this is quite important for us in terms of Monreale, because they make Palermo one of the most important cities. And the Bishop of Palermo gets kind of thrown out of his cathedral. And although the Christians are kind of tolerated by the Arab emirs in Sicily, they have to leave their great churches in Palermo, most of which are turned into mosques. And the Bishop of Palermo moves up into the hills to Monreale, in fact, is the see of Palermo, moves to a tiny little church in the village of Monreale up in the hills behind Palermo. At this point, this is where the great kind of schism happens, 1054, and the Western Church and the Eastern Church split. And because Sicily is historically connected to the Byzantines, most Christians in Sicily are in fact of the Orthodox persuasion by the time the Normans arrive. So in 1060, we begin with the Norman invasion of Sicily. And this is where we really get to the important part for us today. So what were the Normans doing down in Sicily? And this is quite an extraordinary story about one family in particular, the de Hautevilles, who were a family of kind of minor Norman nobility from up in Normandy, not very far away from England at all. And this man called Tancred de Hauteville, who in fact is, we can see here, and if you recognize that particular, that style's pretty unique. Do you know where that's from? The Bayeux tapestry, in fact. So Tancred de Hauteville is shown on the Bayeux tapestry with his kind of Latinized name, Hauteville, Altavilla. And he's there, Tancred, together with his wife and his 12 sons. So he had 12 sons and not a lot of land. So they worked out that he probably had enough land to support 4 sons, and the other 8 sons go off in search of their fortune. And this is a time when, you know, there's beginning to think about the reconquest of the Holy Land, and the pilgrimage trail down towards the Holy Land passed through southern Italy, and the 8 sons of Tancred de Hauteville go past Rome, go down into the south of Italy, and prove extremely effective in both battle and administration, and slowly begin to fight with the Greeks, who are the Byzantine Greeks in the south of Italy, and take over the land there. In particular, one of the sons, Roger, becomes the count of the foot of Italy, the toe of Italy, and has himself crowned as king. So here you can see King Roger. You can see here written in Greek, Rogerios Rex. And since nobody was willing to crown him, he decides to go to the boss himself and have himself crowned, at least in iconographical terms, by Jesus himself. So this is kind of within a couple of generations from Tancred, you have Roger being crowned the king in southern Italy, and then they go into his son, Roger II, is recognized as king of Sicily by Pope Innocent II in 1135. So they begin, these brothers and their descendants begin to reconquer Sicily from the Moors. So a small force of Norman knights cross over to Messina, about 1,000 of them, and they just begin slowly to conquer the whole of Sicily. Within 70 years, the whole of Sicily is under their control. At this point, we can speak a little bit about the connection with England, which is quite strong. Tancred de Hauteville was one of William the Conqueror's kind of buddies, and he came to conquer England together with him. And within 3 generations, or 4 generations, in fact, we get to the important people today that we're going to speak about today. And this is William II. Known in Sicily as Guglielmo il Buono, William the Good, who marries Joan of England. Now, Joan of England was the daughter of Henry II and Eleanor of Aquitaine. Her brother is famously known as Richard the Lionheart. Yeah? So she becomes the queen consort of Sicily. And once William and Joan have kind of sorted out the problems that always follow the handover of from one monarch to another, William I and William II, they have an uninterrupted period of about 20 years of peace in Sicily. At this point, William II begins work on some extraordinary buildings, and he begins to kind of leave his mark on his capital in Palermo. So he begins to build two churches in particular. The first is Palermo Cathedral. So this is the cathedral that you'll find in Sicily. All of this part here was built by William II. This is a later addition, as you can probably tell. And it's an extraordinary building from the outside, really quite beautiful. It was decorated inside, but nowhere near as magnificently as the other cathedral that William II starts to build, which is the cathedral that we're going to speak about today. So, as I said, when the Normans arrived in Sicily, most Sicilians were Orthodox. They were celebrating the Orthodox liturgy, and Greek was the kind of lingua franca of the church there. When the Normans arrived, they begin to introduce the Gallican rite, the rite that was used in France, slowly Latin, I mean, not even so slowly, Latin kind of takes over from Greek. So the Palatine Chapel made by Roger I, all the inscriptions are in Greek. Two generations later, all the inscriptions that we'll see in Monreale are in Latin. And the other thing that he does here in Monreale is he invites the Cluniac Benedictines to make a large monastery, and the Cathedral of Monreale is the church of this Benedictine monastery. So up till then, all the monastic orders, all the monastic communities in Sicily had been Orthodox, and this is the first community that comes kind of from the Western Rite. So this cathedral was kind of looked after by a fantastically named Gualtiero of Famiglio, whose English name was Walter of the Mill. He was the Archbishop of Palermo, and he had a bit of a kind of power struggle with the king, and so the king just decided to build another cathedral 9 miles up the road and set up another bishopric there to keep Gualtiero under control. So as you can see, the cathedral in Monreale is from a kind of architectural point of view, certainly from the outside, nowhere near as spectacular as the cathedral in Palermo. But what we really know it for are the mosaics inside. Now, work begins on this cathedral in 1174, and it's finished in 1182, so it's incredibly quick, the works that happen here. In 8 years, he managed to finish the whole building, including the decoration. Here we see a really amazing kind of blend of French, Norman, Romanesque, so the kind of very solid, almost kind of very masculine way of building. Very solid, big columns, thick walls, not too high. Everything looks extremely solid, you know, very typical of the kind of Norman Romanesque. Together with that, we have this Byzantine Greek form of decoration. So, you know, you would not feel, you know, if you saw this in northern France, if you saw this type of building in northern France, it wouldn't be unusual. What is unusual is this kind of gold iconographic decoration. And the third part, which really is very unique to Sicily, are these kind of pointed arches which come straight from Arabia, and also the what we call the dado here, which is made of in geometrical patterns, which is kind of straight out of any kind of mosque that would have been built in the area as well. So we see the marrying of these three different kind of cultures, the Greek, the Norman, and the Arabic. So the church is not huge, but it's quite an imposing building. It's about 100 meters long by about 40 meters wide. It contains the largest cycle of mosaics, of Byzantine mosaics that we have left to us. It's even bigger than St. Mark's Basilica in Venice. There are 7,600 square meters of mosaic in the building, with over 120 separate scenes or figures from the Bible and the saints, etc. And although I don't think anyone's counted, there has been an estimate that the tesserae, you know, the little squares that you use to make mosaics, there are over 100 million tesserae used to make the decorations in the cathedral. Now, at this point, I just want to say a little word about mosaic techniques that are used here. So mosaics are we begin to see the kinds of mosaics that we see are made of glass. So each of these little tesserae, each of the little squares, is essentially made of glass paste. So what they would do is they would kind of make the color. They would then kind of lay it out, you know, in a mold, make a flat sheet, cook it, and then cut it into little squares. That's what the system of mosaics that's used. I mean, there were earlier systems using pebbles and things, but obviously you would never get the same amount of kind of color in there. Now, this was a technique that was already being used around the 4th century BC, but the Romans, who really perfected kind of the science of producing glass, really brought sort of mosaic technique into the first century, as we could say. They really became extremely expert at it and did some incredible work. And they had various kind of classes of mosaic, and each type would be more expensive than the other. At the very top, this is the kind of best quality mosaic that we've kind of found. This is the Alexander mosaic that's found in Pompeii. And this was done in a style called opus vermiculatum. So opus vermiculatum, that word vermiculatum means kind of like worms. And basically the tesserae were so small, so they would be under 4 millimeters. They'd be so small that they would follow the colors kind of according to the line, you know, the face or around the eyes. And you'd get this kind of snaky type of effect as the colors kind of followed the lines. So in this particular mosaic, the each tesserae is about 2 millimeters wide. Yeah, so between 2 and 4 millimeters wide, you get an incredibly detailed effect. And the Romans really were great experts at this. And that was the most expensive type of mosaic. Usually it was used in kind of small scenes that were set within a kind of cheaper surround. There was this opus regulatum, which was literally, you know, little squares kind of put in a regular pattern. And there was a limit that was usually for geometric shapes. And they wouldn't really use that to show kind of pictures. The most common was opus tessellatum, where each tesserae was about half a centimeter wide or a bit bigger. And that is the style that's used in Monreale. The other one is opus sectile, which is where you would cut the stone to the shape that you wanted. And that's often used for flooring. And then you'd go up and up. And then the cheapest was something called opus scutellatum, where you just take broken kind of fragments of glass or stone and put them usually in a floor. It's kind of our what we would call crazy paving. Yeah. So next time somebody asks you if you want your drive done, you say, yes, I'll have it in opus scutellatum. Thank you very much. So going into the actual cathedral itself, William II was very clear about the reason he was doing this, and he wanted to show it off as an action of piety and a way of showing his power. So on the left, so this is basically when you go into the church, as you get up to the choir, you get to the presbyterium where the priests were, and there was a seat also for the king there. On either side, you have these two mosaics. And on the left, you can see here you see it says Rex Guillermus Secondo, and he as well. I mean, the descendants of Tancred, they had a bit of a chip on their shoulder about their kind of lowly origins, and so they were constantly being shown crowned by Jesus Christ himself. And in this case, you can see the Christ, who is there in the apse, the very same one holding the same book with the same text. He's there crowning King William II. And interestingly, you can see here there's a little legend here, which is a quotation from Psalm 88. Verse 22. It says, "Manus enim mea auxiliabitur ei," and that means, "My hand shall always remain with him." And it's interesting when you read on in that psalm, it says, "I have set the crown on one who is mighty. I have exalted one chosen from the people. I have found my servant David. With my holy oil I've anointed him. And my hand shall always remain with him." So very much they saw themselves as chosen by God to look after this island of Sicily. And on the right-hand side, and in fact the Cathedral of Monreale is dedicated to Our Lady, you can see King William here handing a kind of generic church. It looks nothing like the Cathedral of Monreale, but he's handing over a church to Our Lady, who's accepting it from her throne. And you can see God's hand kind of poking out of heaven, blessing the whole enterprise. So let's go ahead and have a look at the basilica itself. So it's a pretty classic kind of basilica. Now the word basilica comes from the Greek basileus meaning king, and it was essentially a shape that was borrowed from the secular sphere, and it was essentially a kind of throne room. So you'd have a long nave and then a raised area with an apse, and in the apse would be sitting the king. And you get these buildings in kind of Roman cities. In Rome you see them a lot, and they were the kind of big public meeting spaces, and they were extremely good for the kind of things that the Christians wanted to do as well. So they immediately took over these buildings and this shape to make their own churches. And in fact, the basilica is made with this central nave, kind of wide nave, and two nave aisles. So all of these decorated, obviously, and we'll go through that. And then when you get to this area, you begin with the choir. So this is the area where the priests and clerics would be. Then you go to, it looks like a kind of like a different building really. You go to a kind of triple nave with three apses, and I'll talk you through a little bit the kind of scheme. All around you have, so here you have the narthex, which is just the entrance. No decorations in there, but there's some pretty fantastic bronze gates, 12th century bronze gates that are there and in excellent nick, that were brought down from Pisa. And then you have a kind of colonnade on the outside, and then various little chapels built around the side. For example, here you have a later chapel of the crucifix built in this horrific Baroque style. Sorry, you had to see that. But we can go on with the rather nicer stuff. So there are various kind of cycles of mosaics that follow around the basilica. Starting down here with the book of Genesis, so we have the whole of creation that runs along that wall. So here's an example, and it's lovely. And you'll see that Christ who's in the apse, the famous Christ Pantocrator. He appears all over the mosaics. They take very literally the fact that, you know, the Word was God, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, and everything was created through him. So that the work of creation is not done by, in a sense, by God the Father. At this point, still depicting God the Father was something that was not done very much. But you see God the Son acting on behalf of God the Father, creating the whole universe. So unlike the creation of Michelangelo, you don't see the old man God the Father creating, but you see the younger God the Son. Everything was created through him, and here you see him creating the animals. So this phrase kind of carries on all the way around into the book of Genesis, the fall, and then we get to some of the stories from the book of Genesis, especially the stories that prefigure Christ in some way. So this is the sacrifice of Isaac. So this is Abraham going up to the top of Mount Moriah. And as he's about to strike the sun on the altar, the angel comes out of the heavens. You'll see this is a kind of a motif that's repeated throughout the mosaics. So whenever anything happens out of heaven, you get these kind of concentric circles, blue circles. The angel comes down and says, ne extendas mani tuam super puerum. So don't stretch out your hand against the boy. Yeah. And beautifully, as you know, he doesn't, because God himself provides the ram for the sacrifice, who gets caught in a bush. And it's interesting that the bush in which he's caught is an aloe vera plant there, which you'll see all over the place in Sicily. So a little bit of local colour there. So we carry on with the stories from Genesis all the way through to Jacob fighting with the angel. So it's lovely how in some of the single scenes you have kind of different moments of the story. So up at the top you can see there it says Jacob Fudjiebat. So Jacob kind of runs away, and then he begins to fight with the angel by the river. And here you can see that he gives him his new name, Israel. Okay. So that's the kind of the Old Testament runs all the way around here. And then we move on to, so it just stays with Genesis out of the Old Testament, and then it skips straight to the infancy narratives of Jesus Christ's life there in the choir. And you can see, for example, here, the presentation in the temple. So all the infancy narratives go around this area here, which is in the choir. And then you move on to the life of Christ. So here on the south, is it the south? Yes, on the south side, you have Jesus's temptations and his ministry, essentially starting with his temptations and going to the Last Supper. And here you can see him, the story here of the temptations in the desert. You can see Jesus holding his hand in this gesture of teaching, holding the scriptures, the scriptures in his hand, with which he answers every time the devil tempts him. You can see the bread here, or the stones rather, falling to the ground. So we move, and I should have said at the beginning that obviously the whole church is on a classic kind of east-west axis, with the apse facing to the east. After that, we go to the miracles of Christ. So, as I was saying, we have this big central nave, and then the nave aisles. Okay, and in the nave aisles, we have a series that goes all the way around and comes back up here of the miracles of Christ. So Jesus showing his power as the Messiah, and the miracle, it's incredibly easy to read when you go in. I mean, these were things made for kind of illiterate people, and they're beautifully simple. As I was saying before, we often go to Mass there in the summer, and it gets very hot in Sicily, although in the cathedral it's always quite cool. There's a saying in Italian that, che nel tempo dei meloni non si fanno sermoni, which is, when the melons are ripe, you don't make sermons because it's so hot that everybody kind of needs to get in and out of the church fairly quickly. So the masses there are done quite quickly. The liturgy is usually terrible, but you just sit there and you just, you're kind of bathed in this gold and you look around, and every story is really beautifully, kind of, they always capture the moment that really explains exactly what's going on. So here we see Jesus healing the man with a withered hand. After the miracle, so we come back round and we go into the north nave here, where we have the Passion to the Pentecost. So we have the kind of Jesus beginning his passion and going towards his glorification, with, for example, here the scene Traditio Domini, the betrayal of Christ, with the kiss of Judas there. Wonderfully kind of full scene, with lots of kind of movement there in the middle. And Jesus taken by the wrist. This is always a sign of being taken somewhere you don't want to go, that you're not taken by the hand, but you're taken by the wrist. So you have no choice about the matter. So after that, we have these kind of the two smaller apses follow the show the lives of the two great saints of the early church, St. Peter and St. Paul. So St. Peter, there's the story, all his story told through Acts, going up towards his own martyrdom in Rome. And there's this wonderful picture of Peter being crucified upside down. As you know, he didn't feel worthy to die in the same way as Christ, so they hang him upside down. As you can see there, they've basically just taken a crucifix and turned it around. There's no kind of sense of the kind of weight coming down at all, but and it's a lovely little detail here that this kind of generic city over here, just in case you didn't know, is Roma. So just to tell you that he's crucified on the Vatican there in Rome. On the other side, we have the life of St. Paul and all his adventures in the book of Acts. And this is his escape from, I think it's... from Damascus, there you are. So they wanted to kill Paul and they put guards on all the gates, so they knew that when he tried to escape, they could stop him and kill him. And his disciples take him during the night to the wall and lower him over the side of the wall in a big basket. And that's how he escapes from the city of Damascus. So great little story there. And then we move to essentially the most important kind of set of mosaics, which is the Pantocrator and the saints in the main apse. So the big scene that you see as you come into the church from the west, looking towards the east. There you are. So every part has a number of levels. There's three in the main nave. When you move into the kind of taller part where of the choir, it goes even to kind of five levels at one point, obviously always going towards the most important one at the top. And here we have Christ with Our Lady underneath, and some of the more important kind of ecclesial saints down here, which we'll talk about in a minute. So let's talk a little bit about the most famous of the scenes, most famous of the figures in the Cathedral in Monreale, which is the Pantocrator, the Christ Pantocrator in the apse, in the eastern apse. So the Pantocrator is a very interesting type of icon, essentially, which developed probably around the 4th-5th century. The oldest one that we have is the very famous Egyptian one from the monastery of St. Catherine, I think, isn't it? Which is painted in wax on wood. And it's a very beautiful icon, and one of the oldest that we have. And as I was saying before, we were talking about the Arian heresy, where Jesus Christ was less than God. And the Pantocrator really is a type which comes in opposition to that mistaken belief about Christ. I mean, it's interesting. If we look here, this is a picture of Christ taken from the Arian baptistry in Ravenna, made under the kind of influence of Arianism, where Christ, in order to show Christ as less than God the Father, less important, there was a time when he was not. He's often shown as much younger, beardless, a boy, essentially. You know, here's John the Baptist. What was the age difference between John the Baptist and Jesus? 3 months. Whereas, you know, John the Baptist is sporting a big full beard. Jesus is little more than a boy. So this was a very common way during the kind of Arian heresy of showing Christ, that in order to show him as kind of less important, more human, less divine, he was always shown as a younger man. Whereas the Pantocrator came in opposition to that belief to kind of re-establish Christ as God and man. And in fact, that very phrase, the Pantocrator, which comes from the Greek pan, everything, and kratio, to do with power, so powerful over all, comes to re-establish Christ and in his divinity. And in fact, in the Septuagint, in the translation into Greek of the Old Testament, the word Yahweh Sabaoth, is often translated as Pantocrator. So when we talk about Christ Pantocrator, we're talking about Christ, the Almighty God, essentially. And you can see across here, it says Ho Pantocrator. So it's being very clear. So at the top here, as you always get on the icons of Jesus Christ, you have the name of Christ, the first and the last letters, Jesus. Then you've got a little squiggle which shows you that there's some letters missing. And then Christos, first letter and the last letter. Why does it look like a C? Well, this is what's called a lunate sigma, which was in use in that kind of 5th century period onwards. It's a stylistic kind of evolution of the sigma, the S in Greek, which is shown as a C. So you'll always get this IC, XC, which is in fact a IS, S. Jesus Christos. Now, this particular kind of type of the Pantocrator is sometimes known as the Pantocrator teacher icon, because Jesus is often shown holding a book. Sometimes it's closed, and when he's teaching, it's open. And we can see here on this side that the book is open, and in fact, it's like a bilingual version of the Bible, with on the left in Greek and on the right in Latin, and it says, I am the light of the world. Whoever believes in me will not stumble. So it's Jesus as the teacher, Jesus as the light, Jesus as God. The other gesture which is important is his hand gesture, which speaks about the two fingers, speak about his natures, his two natures as man and as God, and the three fingers together point to his membership of the Holy Trinity. The other important thing to note is that always when you see Christ in this kind of icon, he'll have over the right shoulder a band of different color. And this, these Pantocrators are always shown as just a bust, but often when he's standing, this band carries on. So he's wearing classic Greek clothing. So this is a chiton, and over the top you have a himation, which is a kind of cloak. And this line here is reminiscent of the line that was given on clothing to senators in Rome. So in Rome, in order to stop the kind of richer citizens of Rome from wearing the same types of clothes as the emperor, they were banned from dyeing the entire cloth that they would wear. Only the emperor could wear purple. Everybody else had to wear white. However, if you were of a certain class, you were allowed to have a band of red or purple that would show your status. And according to how powerful you were, the width of that band would get wider. So if you belonged to the knightly class, it was a very kind of thin band. If you belonged to the senatorial class, that band would get kind of wider. So Jesus has a pretty wide band there, showing his authority. And it also takes us back to one of the readings of Isaiah, where it says, "And dominion will be on his shoulder." So he always has that band. The colors that he wears are also extremely important. So the dual nature of Christ is shown here by the red. So red, purple were imperial colors. They were the color of royalty, the color of divinity. So Jesus wears underneath his divine nature, and he puts over the top his human nature. So we have this kind of blue, dark blue, representing his human nature, over the top of his red imperial divine nature. Whereas just below him is his mother. And here again, you have her name here, Mater, mother, Theou of God. And she has this inscription next to her. So it's Hey Panakrantos, which means the all pure. So we have the Pantocrator at the top and the Panakrantos behind, underneath. And Mary there, she wears her clothing is always the opposite, the other way around. So Jesus wears the red underneath and the blue over the top. He had a divine nature. He put on the human nature. Mary had her human nature, and on top of that was put Christ's divine nature. She was given Christ to bear. She's flanked on either side by the Archangel Michael and the Archangel Gabriel. And she sits on a classic throne, imperial throne, wearing kind of imperial garb. So just kind of going back to here, just to show you kind of the business end of the church here. So we have the Pantocrator up at the top, Our Lady underneath, flanked by the archangels and St. Peter on this side, St. Paul, and the evangelists on either side. And then underneath those most important saints come the next most important. So all of these, you can see, are bishops wearing the pallium. That's right. They're all wearing the pallium. So these are all metropolitan bishops, and they're all martyrs who died for the church. Now, interestingly, we're going to look in a bit more detail at this figure here. So that figure there is Sanctus Thomas of Canterbury. So St. Thomas of Canterbury is there, pretty close to Jesus and Our Lady, in a place of extraordinary importance in this cathedral, which is 3,000 kilometers away from England, on the other side of Europe. And the mosaic of Thomas of Canterbury is put there. Thomas of Canterbury was martyred in 1170. The Church of Monreale is built between 1174 and 1182. So within 5 years of Thomas of Canterbury's death, he's already being represented among the most important saints on the other side of Europe. The other very interesting thing is that Thomas a Becket was killed under the orders of Henry II of England. Now, Henry II is the father of Joan of England, who is the queen, William II's queen, and the one who paid for the building of this cathedral. So it's very interesting that this saint, who was made by Henry II, sending him to be killed, his own daughter ensures that he is placed in a place of great importance. I mean, we know that Henry II did public penance for this egregious sin against the Archbishop of Canterbury and against the independence of the church. And he becomes an extremely important saint throughout Europe, representing really the independence of the church, the ability of the church to speak truth to power in all moments and everywhere. So I just wanted to really kind of finish off by speaking a little bit about a kind of rather odd mosaic that we see there at the eastern end of the church. So you have to imagine that the high altar would be right up against the wall, the back wall of the apse, and the sacrifice of the mass would be offered there, pointing east, looking to Christ who is to come. Every mass celebrated there had this, as it does today, had this eschatological dimension, looking forward to the end times, looking forward to Christ coming again. This is why every church was built on this west-east axis, looking towards the rising sun, looking towards Christ who comes again. And just above, so above the altar, as you would look up, you see this little mosaic here, surrounded by the seraphim. And this mosaic is something called the etymasia. So it's a Greek word, and it's a figure that you will often find, especially in these basilicas in Sicily, but also around the Greek world, which is the empty throne, or rather the prepared throne, the throne that is there ready for Christ to come again. And the throne is always shown with his kind of cloak, ready for him to take his seat of judgment. So this is the throne of the judge, the throne of the king. And Christ goes as king, not surrounded by weapons and great orbs and scepters and symbols of state, but he there waiting for him are the symbols of his victory, the symbols of how he gained salvation for all of humanity. And so we see the spear with which his side was transfixed, the sponge with which he was given to drink on the cross, the cross itself, the crown of thorns, and we see in this little kind of vase by his feet the nails that were driven through his hands and his feet. And there the Holy Spirit is waiting for him, sitting on that himation, on that cloak, which represented Christ's human nature, which he assumes with him up into heaven. And there he will sit, waiting for the end of time to judge the living and the dead. At every Mass, we speak about being ready to meet him when he comes again. And we have this beautiful image looking down into the apse of Christ, powerful over everything, and looking up at that throne prepared for his second coming. And in a sense, the whole of that kind of cycle of decoration of the cathedral points us towards that very scene, that very simple scene of the prepared throne, the etymasia, ready for him to come again. So I think that's a kind of whistle stop tour around the history of Sicily and the incredible work that was done in the 12th century there in the cathedral, which is ready for you to go and visit anytime you want. And I heartily recommend it. It's really a breathtaking experience. You can go around, you can follow really the whole, it's beautiful because it's the whole history of salvation. God from the creation to his second coming. It really encompasses everything, all of kind of human life, all of our existence, the fall going towards our redemption by Christ. So, it was Ryanair tickets. As I showed you earlier on, there's a really impressive 360-degree kind of sort of virtual reality tour that you can look at as well, where you can get a much better idea of how the mosaics function. So, I don't know if anybody's got any questions or any. Sorry, go on.
Sorry, forgive me if it's not that relevant, but mosaics in general.
Mm-hmm.
In, I think it's Tunisia, there's a wonderful museum of Roman mosaics.
Mm.
How would they transfer them from place to place, especially the ancient Roman ones, which presumably aren't glass, they're more stone, I think.
Even the Romans used this kind of glass system. Interesting, I didn't mention, but the gold is actually also in glass. So basically it's gold leaf placed between two pieces of glass. So essentially it's a glass cube with a piece of gold leaf down the middle, which is why they are so kind of resistant and so and that why they continue to shine for the last sort of thousand years, essentially, because they're there encased in glass, very hardy. Now, interestingly, it seems that the opus vermiculatum that I was talking about, those very tiny pieces of mosaic, those were done on pieces of cloth that where kind of glue was spread over the cloth, and they were placed on a desk, very painstaking work one by one. Then they were taken to the place where they would be put up, whether it was a wall or a floor. The cement would be prepared, and then these tesserae would be put on. The backing would be taken off, and then the kind of grout would be put on after that. This opus tesseratum, which is the type that is used in Monreale, is almost certainly the pieces that were put in one by one in situ. And in fact, they were able, and this has been sort of shown in Montreal in particular, they were able even to do things like angle the little squares towards the nearest kind of light source in order for them to be able to kind of pick up the light that there was in the cathedral best. So, you really notice it when you get in, especially at certain times of the day, that there's a real kind of shimmer to those mosaics. So these ones were put in in situ, whereas some of the more kind of detailed work, but that wasn't really used in Monreale, but was used a lot. You can see some really good examples of this opus vermiculatum later ones. If you go to St. Peter's in Rome, there are these incredible mosaics that look like paintings. You only notice that they're mosaics when you go very close up, and they have these kind of tiny tesserae.
Sorry, I'm still not clear how you see a great big Roman mosaic, and it's been taken from Tunisia to Rome.
Right.
How would they do that? It's on the wall.
In those cases, they will literally like just cut the stone underneath and kind of transport it in situ. Or in some cases, they'll actually take the tesserae out one at a time and then reconstruct them in a place. They'll do photography, and the archaeologists will then reconstruct it as it was on the floor in a museum.
Thanks.
Painstaking work.
Yeah.
Yes, sorry.
There's a similarity between the Roman conqueror. He killed King Harold, at least a source of that killing. And the Tancred as well, didn't he? Or his father or grandfather killed the legitimate king. And then they become kings themselves, Now, there's something very funny with that, It can't be God's blessing. It must be a different kind of thing.
Well, yeah. I mean, Tancred, he sticks around in Normandy, and a couple of his sons end up with some land in England, in Somerset, I think. And then the other sons kind of go down to southern Italy and essentially kind of conquer the area. In fact, one of the sons I didn't mention, he goes off with the First Crusade and ends up being made, he becomes the Count of Antioch, if I'm not mistaken.
When you talk about the Normans, it's actually the Vikings, same people.
That's right, yeah. They in fact, this family, the Hauteville's, were able to kind of trace their ancestry back to the Vikings. Yeah. Yes.
What made them such good warriors?
Well, I think partially, you know, that Viking sort of kind of spirit was you know, made them extremely, you know, hardy and brave warriors. But also they had, in terms of kind of military technology, they had some advantages. So, for example, they'd worked out a particular way of getting kind of a lot of soldiers moved in quite small vessels, which was very good both for the invasion of Britain and for the invasion of Sicily. It seems that they used the same type of kind of amphibious warfare. And the other thing is that they were extremely kind of heavily armoured. They used a kind of chainmail, which wasn't really used so much down in the south of Europe. So they had a kind of technological advantage. And it just seems that also this particular family just produced some really kind of impressive, you know, I think to have kind of five out of your children, you know, basically set up kingdoms for themselves is doing pretty well, I think. So, you know, my son's a doctor and my son's a king of Sicily, you know. Yeah.
Is there much said about the architects of the two cathedrals in the sense that,
there's a completely unsubstantiated legend that the two cathedrals in Palermo or near Palermo, they were built by two brothers, and these are the two cathedrals, and one brother worked on the design down in the town in Palermo, and the other one up in the hills in Monreale. So after working on their respective cathedrals for a while, the brother from Monreale goes down to have a look at his brother's handiwork in Palermo and is so gobsmacked by the beauty of the building that he, in shame, he committed suicide. This is the story. And the brother was distraught about this, and he went up to see his brother's work and then went into the cathedral and saw the beauty of the inside of the cathedral, which is, I mean, the cathedral in Palermo has no decorations to speak of, really. Once he saw the inside of Monreale, he realized that his brother was far superior to him, and he also commits suicide. So both of these brothers end up dead for different reasons. But it's interesting that one of the kind of readings of this was also a kind of a way of looking at the human person. The beauty of the human person created by God from the outside, but the much greater beauty of the human person on the inside, of the soul that's given to us by God. So looking at these two cathedrals that were built at the same time, they spoke of different aspects of the human person. Yes. Yes, that's an interesting question because, in fact, Mark spoke about icons. He'll probably be able to answer this question better than I can. But as you know, in iconography, originality is frowned upon. You know that each iconographer is simply called upon to reproduce the classical iconographic kind of motifs, and they change very, very slowly over time. It's a great example of what we call kind of organic development. And it's interesting that some of the icons, you know, they say, so one of the icons in particular of Our Lady, they say goes all the way back to St. Luke. So St. Luke, not only was he a doctor, he's also a patron of artists, and it's said that he painted the very first icon of Our Lady from life. You know, he knew her and he saw her. And so one of the reasons why they try and stay very close to the kind of the model on which they're basing their icon is because these icons were said to have gone back right to the beginning, to the people who saw Christ and who saw the scenes themselves. I don't know if you wanted to add anything.
No, I think you've covered it beautifully.
Okay, all right, thank you. He spoke about the icon of Our Lady of Kazan at the last talk. So that's anything else?
Yeah, I think they're buried. Are these buried there?
That's right. Yeah, William. William is buried there, and his Roger is also buried there. And interestingly, there's also the only extant relics of King Louis of France. So they were also this connection that they kept with the old country, with France, meant that some of the heart of King Louis of France was brought to Monreale, and it's still there, in fact. And in fact, all of the relics of King Louis were destroyed during the French Revolution, and the only extant ones are actually in Sicily and Monreale. So it also has a huge kind of granite tomb, a couple of tombs of these kings of Sicily down kind of here. It's able to visit them. I mean, just to say, almost all of the cathedral is kind of original. It's in its original state. The only part that was really reconstructed, that there was a fire in 1811, which destroyed much of the roof, which is all wooden, but it's been restored in a very spectacular way, and it seems very kind of closely to close to the original. Another thing just to say is that these columns here, they are in fact ancient Roman columns, and this was a feature that of many churches down in the south of Italy in particular, kind of recycling ancient bits of building material. So both the columns and the capitals are ancient. They predate the church by about 1,000 years.